So, like introduced, I'm Meni, I'm from the Israeli Bitcoin Association, and I'm here to talk to you a bit about mining pool reward methods. Now, I have to give a few disclaimers. So first, this talk will be rather technical. I won't get too much into the technical details, but it's a change of pace from Peter's talk. There aren't going to be any pictures of beavers here, so be prepared. And unlike some of the other talks you may have heard this week, this isn't based on some recent development or a new hot breakthrough. Actually, most of the research that this talk is based on is about 6 years old. But I think it is an interesting topic that is very fundamental to how Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies work. And I think it's not enough people are aware of it. So I thought it was good to present to you this, these topics. So yeah. So first, I need to remind you a bit what mining is. So actually, mining is a computational system, a proof-of-work system, which exists for two purposes. One is to determine the initial distribution of coins, and the other is to synchronize the transactions. Now, the way it works is miners calculate hashes. For every hash that they calculate, they have a chance of finding a block. Now, it doesn't matter for our purposes what is the hash function or what they're hashing or why, but it just compute a lot of hashes, and each hash has a chance to be a block. And if they find a block, they get some bitcoins, or in any other cryptocurrency, the coins of that coin. Now, so the reason miners are spending their resources to do this is because they get rewards. So how it works is that one hash in 4 billion, or 2 to the 33, becomes a share, and every share has a probability to be a block. So if there is some parameter of the network called D, which is the difficulty, and the probability of a share to be a block is 1 over D. So right now the difficulty is about 900 billion. And now whenever a block is found, it is rewarded with some number of bitcoins, call it B. Right now it's 12.5 plus transaction fees. Now I'm going to ignore transaction fees most of the talk, even though they've become a bit significant, but for simplicity we'll just assume that it's 12.5 bitcoins for every block. And this means that if each share has a probability of P to reward with B bitcoins, then the expected reward per share is P times B. So for example, suppose we have a mining farm of 1 petahash per second, which is about 100 modern machines. Now if you plug in all the numbers, you'll get this miner finds about 840 million shares per hour. And that means that every year, he will get on average 8.16 blocks, which is about 100 bitcoins. So that's the basic idea. However, there is a problem. And the problem is variance. The process in which miners find blocks is random. I'm not guaranteed to have found the exact same number of blocks I mentioned, because this is all very random. I just try hashes one after the other, and each one has a probability to be a block. And if I didn't find a block, it doesn't increase my chances to find in the future. So it's all random. So I could find a lot of blocks, or I could find no blocks at all. And this process follows the Poisson process, the number of blocks found in a period of time follows the Poisson distribution. And one of the features of this distribution is that the variance is equal to the mean. So like I said, if I find some number of shares, then the average number of blocks I'm supposed to find is the number of shares divided by the difficulty. And this is also equal to the variance in the number of blocks. And the standard deviation is the square root of that, which means that if I compare the average number of blocks I'm supposed to find to the standard deviation, the ratio is the square root of the difficulty divided by the number of shares. So if in some period of time I find a lot of shares, then the relative variance is small, and what I get would be more or less what I'd expect. But if I only found a small number of shares, then the relative variation will be huge. And if we try it with some numbers, So we take the same one petahash per second miner, and he's been mining for a year with a block reward of 12.5 and difficulty of 900 billion. Then the average reward he would get is about 100 bitcoins, but the standard deviation of that amount would be 35.7, which means that in this year of mining, he can get anywhere from 0 to 200 bitcoins. And this is a pretty large variance, right? So, and I'm talking about a miner who is not small, he has a lot of resources and he's been mining for a year, and there's a very good chance he would find no blocks at all in this time. So this is a problem both from a business perspective, right? If I have a mining business and I have costs both upfront and ongoing for running this mining hardware, then I expect to get the mining reward so I can pay for it all. So if there's a chance that I will not get anything, it's a problem, I would go bankrupt. And also if you're talking about a small at-home miner, right, an individual buys one machine and runs it, then first his relative variance would be much higher because we'll find less shares, and there's a very significant psychological cost here. And this I can testify from my own experience back when Bitcoin mining was still done with GPUs, and I had a few machines that were running, and the anxiety about the number of blocks I'm finding kept me up at night. I would lay awake in bed, and I was wondering, did I find a block just now or not? Or maybe I should go wake up and see if I find blocks. And it's very, very taxing psychologically. So this is the problem. Fortunately, there is a solution, and the solution is mining pools. That too, but the basic idea of a mining pool is that instead of each miner trying to find blocks on his own, several numbers band together in a pool, and they all try to find blocks together, and they share their rewards. Now, this means that the number of reward each miner would get would be a sort of average of what all the other miners are doing. So the more people band together this way, they can smooth out the rewards. Because if we do all the calculations, we see that when you add more miners, you multiply the mean reward and you multiply the variance, and the relative variance would be much smaller. So all in all, this allows the mining rewards to work how we could expect they should have worked in the first place, right? And we get a continuous stream of the rewards proportional exactly to how much resources we've put in. Now, in order for the pool to know how much each miner contributed and reward them accordingly, there is the concept of shares, and since shares are plentiful, it's easy to count them to see how much shares each miner submitted, and each share has a chance to be a block and reward the pool in general, and the miner is rewarded in exact proportion to how many blocks, how many shares he has found. And if it was as simple as that, I could have stopped my talk here, but the problem is that it's not so simple, and the actual way in which we calculate how much reward we should give to each miner, it's not a trivial problem. And this is why there are several methods which are used to determine the rewards in a mining pool. And I'm going to describe several of these methods. Now, the first method I'll talk about, which is very simple, it's called pay per share, which is more or less what you would expect. Whenever a miner finds a share, he will get a reward, right? I mentioned that the average reward that the pool would get for the share is P times B. So whenever I submit a share, I get P times B of reward from the pool. Now, this reward is given to me from the pool operator, and whenever a block is found, the operator collects the reward. So this actually transfers the problem to the operator, because now the miners are completely safe from variance. Every share they submit, they get the reward that they should, but the operator has all this variance because he has to pay for every share that is submitted, but he only gets money when the pool finds a block. It can find more blocks or less blocks. There is risk for the operator. So it's the advantages of this simple is, of course, that it's very simple. Miners don't have any randomness or variance or whatever, and they can get the payment instantly. But the variance is entirely assumed by the operator. If the pool is lucky, the operator will get a lot of money. But if the pool is unlucky and it doesn't find blocks, and the operator has to pay out of pocket, then he could go bankrupt. And we could calculate what is the probability of eventually going bankrupt, assuming we start with some reserve, and the pool takes a fee of some proportion, and you can calculate what is the chance of bankruptcy, and it's rather high because there's a lot of variance. It's very risky, and so this is a viable method. It's not that we can't use this method, but it's difficult to get right, and the operator will probably want to charge a lot of fees to compensate for the risk he's taking. Now, due to these problems, a different method was developed, which is the proportional method. Now, in this method, we separate the activity of the pool to rounds. Each time a block is found, one round ends and another begins. And whenever a block is found, its reward is distributed among the miners who participated in this round. Right? So in this case, the operator doesn't pay anything out of pocket. Whenever a block is found, the rewards are given among the different miners. But the problem with this is that this method is completely broken. And to explain why, we need to look at the assumption that the proportional method would work if all the miners mined in the pool all the time, and then it will all even out, right? Each miner will get rewards in proportion to how much work he is doing, and of course he will be subject to variance based on whether the pool is lucky or not, but of course it's much smaller variance than if he tried to mine solo. However, this assumption that all the miners just contribute all the time to the pool is incorrect. So it turns out, and I'll explain in a moment why, that in this method, there are times where it is more profitable to mine for the pool than others. So if we have a malicious miner, then in those times when it's more lucrative to mine to the pool, he will mine there. But the times where it's less lucrative, he will go elsewhere to another pool or mine solo, and he will get more rewards than what is due. And the other miners who stuck with the pool all the time will get less. So this is a method that allows an attacker to siphon away funds from the other miners. This, if I haven't mentioned, this problem is called pool hopping, where the miner is hopping between different pools depending on when it is more profitable in each. And it's quite easy to see why we get this situation that sometimes are better than others, because the proportional method is based on the wrong intuitions. If we remember, the proportional method says we wait until a block is found and we distribute the rewards between everyone who contributed from the last block to this one. And this would work quite well if mining was deterministic, right? If there was a set amount of work that is needed for each block, then sure, no problem. We find a block, we distribute the rewards. We find another block, we distribute the rewards, like building a wall or something, right? Let's say we need to put in 1 million bricks to put a wall. And once we built the wall, we distribute the rewards for building this wall, proportional to how much bricks each person put. But this is not the case here in mining because, like we said, this is a completely random process. It's what's called a memoryless process, right? If the pool has struggled for some time and didn't find a block, they are not more likely to find a block than they did in the past. It's basically lost effort. Every effort that they've been doing and they didn't complete the task, it's like they haven't done anything at all. And what this means is that if we look at the reward for each share, then it's basically equal to the block reward divided by the number of shares which have been found in a round, right? It could be a short round where two blocks were found, one after the other, and then there will be less shares in this round. And it could be a long round. If the pool is working, and it doesn't find a block, it will be a long round where a lot of shares have been accumulated, and the reward needs to be distributed among all of them. Now, so of course, the more shares there are in a round, the less I would get for every share that I submitted. Now, that if I take a specific point in time and I consider should I mine to this pool or should I mine elsewhere, then I can see what is the number of past shares in this round, right? The round has been going on for some time and some number of shares have been found, but more shares will be found in the future. And the total number of shares would be the sum of these two things. Now, the number of past shares is of course known. I can look at the history and see what's been going on. The number of future shares is unknown, but it's the same every time. Because this is a memoryless distribution, my estimates for how many shares will be found in the future is the same at any moment in time. So if I mine for the pool at the beginning of a round, where there haven't been found many shares yet, then on average, there will be less shares total in the round than if I had tried to mine at a time after the round has been going on for some time, and there are a lot of my shares in the past. Right? So I want to mine for the pool when there aren't a lot of other shares that I'm competing with for the rewards. So the technique is basically, when the pool has just found a block and it starts a new round, I will mine for it. My expected reward for each share will be higher than the normal average because the number of past shares is low. Once it passes some threshold and there are too many shares I would have to compete with once I found the block, then I go elsewhere to another pool or solo. And you could do some calculations if you take the current number of past shares and you calculate with the distributions for how many shares will be found, you can find what is the average reward I would get as a function for how long the round has been going on. And the two things that matter here is the number of shares that have already been found divided by the difficulty, right? The ratio between how much shares have been found to how many should be found on average per round. The lower it is, the higher will be the average reward. And it goes according to this graph here. So for example, if it's been a really long round and the number of shares that have been found is three times as much as the average you should expect, then every share I submit now will be only worth about 20% of the normal amount, which should be kind of obvious because I will clearly share the reward with all the shares that have already been submitted and those in the future. But if I mine when the round has just started, then I could get much more than the P times B, which I should have. That's because if I submit a share just in the beginning, that there is a chance that it will be a block and then I will get the whole thing for myself. Or maybe it will be in the next share, and then I will get half the rewards, and so on. I would get this chance of getting a very large reward increases my average. And yes? So yes, that is exactly what is happening with some of the other methods, which I will describe soon. I will just say that with the normal proportional method, the magic point is 43.5%. Up until that point, it's profitable to mine for the pool. once more than 43.5% of the difficulty have been found, then I should go elsewhere. Yes, so in order to find a solution to the problems caused by the proportional method, another method was developed, which is called the geometric method, which is based on two main aspects. So one aspect is that the operator is taking a bit more of an active role than in the proportional method. So if I said that in the proportional method, the operator doesn't take any risk at all, in the geometric method, it does. And the way this helps is because if the round has just started and the would-be pool hopper wants to say, okay, I'll mine now, and since I'm not competing with anyone else, I will get a large chunk of the reward, the operator says, no, 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 if you mine now and there aren't others you're competing with, then I will get the reward. I will not give everything to you. I will keep most of it. But on the other hand, if the round has been going on for some time, the operator says, okay, I will pay out of my own pocket, so it will still be profitable to mine in this pool, even though it's competing with a lot of shares, but I will provide some extra so that it's still viable to mine here. The other aspect is that the reward a miner gets for a share decays. If I submit a share now, and a lot of time has passed until a block was found, the reward that I get will be much less than if I had submitted a share close to when the round was found. So this means that, again, it changes the profit estimates for someone mining in the beginning of the round, because I said in the proportional method, if the round has just started, then if a block is found soon, I will get the jackpot. If the round carries on, then I will still get something. So here we're saying, no, if the block is found soon, you will not get the jackpot, the operator will get the jackpot, and if the round has been going on for some time, then you will get almost nothing because your share has decayed over time. And if we play with all the parameters and calculations and decay correctly, then we get a situation that no matter when the share was submitted, the average reward will be the same and exactly equal to P times B minus the fee that the operator is taking. And actually, in this method, there are two parameters you can play with. One is the fixed fee that the operator is taking, and the other is the variable fee, where if this is a fee that depends on the luck of the pool. If the pool is luckier, he will get more rewards, and if it's not as lucky, it will take a lower fee, and this helps reduce the variance for the miners. Okay, so, but of course, so this method is completely hopping proof, but it still requires the operator to take some risk, and some operators don't like it. So that's why there is another method called PPLNS, or pay per last N shares, which is based on, this method actually completely removes the notion of rounds, right? In both proportional and geometric, there are rounds which start and end whenever a block is found. Here, there are no rounds. Whenever a block is found, a reward is given for all the miners that have submitted shares within a window of the last N shares. And this means that the same share can be paid out multiple times. If I submit a share and a block is found, I would get a reward for it. If another block is found within the window of N shares, I will get another reward. So this means that for every share, I could get no rewards, or I could get multiple rewards. And because it doesn't depend on the path of the pool, it only depends on how many blocks will be found in the future, the expected reward per share that I submit will be exactly the same no matter when I submit it. And this is why this method is hopping proof.
Why do you need the pool?
because you reduce the variance, because I get, okay, so first the variance depends on the number of shares back that I'm looking. But let's say that I'm looking at the number of past shares equal to 10 times the difficulty. So this means that for every share I submit, my reward will be based on the number of blocks found within the next 10 times the shares, which averages it out. My reward eventually will depend on the luck of the entire pool and not just the luck of myself as a miner, right? Because it's quite probable that in this time I would personally find no blocks at all. But the pool will find blocks and I will get a reward for it because I submitted the share. And finally, there is another method which is a bit more advanced, which is basically a sort of combination of the geometric method and the PPLNS, where the disadvantage of PPLNS that I have to wait a long time to get the rewards because I don't get all the rewards when a block is found. I have to wait for several blocks until I get the rewards. So the DGM tries to combine these two aspects so you can actually configure how much variance the operator wants to take and how much time will it take for the miners to get the rewards. And the basic idea is that when a miner submits a share, his score increases, and this score decays exponentially whenever a share is found and whenever a block is found. And this is analogous to a capacitor, which is charged whenever the miner submits a share, and it gets discharged over time and when blocks are found, and whenever a block is found, the reward I get will be proportional to how much charge I have in my capacitor. And this method has three parameters which can configure how much feed the operator takes in total and how much variance he absorbs and how much miners have to wait until they get the rewards. And the different methods can be described in a sort of triangle where each side represents a desirable feature. So this side represents having no variance for the miners. This side represents having no risk for the operator. And this side represents getting the payments instantly. So if we consider some of the methods we've discussed, so Solely mining is here. You get the reward immediately when you find a block, and there is no operator, so there's no operator risk, so I get all the reward, but it has the maximal variance, right? This point is far away from this edge, so this means this is the maximal variance for the miner. And in this corner, we have PPS, which I get the reward instantly, and I have no variance, but the operator is taking a lot of risks, so I will have to pay him a high fee to compensate for it. And in this corner, we have PPLNS, where we set the window to be arbitrarily high, so in the limit, it means I submit a share now, and I get a reward based on how many blocks the pool is found in the next 100 years. Right, so this reduces my variance completely because in 100 years there will be no variance in the number of blocks, but it means I will have to wait 100 years to get all of my rewards. And within these methods, so this line, the black line represents the geometric method with a parameter that allows us to configure how much risk the operator is taking and how much risk the miners are taking. And the double geometric method has several parameters where we can choose any point we want on the triangle, depending on what matters to us more, if we want less variance for miners or less risk for the operator or less time until we get the rewards. Okay, yeah, and there's actually one more method I want to discuss, which is shift PPLNS, which is very similar to PPLNS, but instead of looking at shares, we separate the work into shifts. So I'm doing much worse on time than I expected, but hopefully I will finish what I had to say. Actually, I think I'd rather move on. And yeah, so I haven't finished yet. I just want to give a perspective for how things have been going on so far and what will happen in the future. So until now, most of the mining pools have been using one of the methods I described. And actually, back in 2011, 2012, the proportional method was very popular, which is a shame because it is broken, and there was actually propaganda against the other methods, which are not as broken. And unfortunately, many people have picked the side of the proportional methods, and it was said and it didn't further a solution. But thankfully, over time, people switched over to the methods which are immune to pool hopping. But there are still problems, and we do need more sophisticated methods for the future. And the problem is that size does matter. So the larger a pool is, the better the performance it will have. Right? The miners go to a pool to reduce the variance, for example. The larger the pool is, the less variance the miners will have. So that depends. So if it's PPLNS, there's less variance for the miners. If it's PPS, there will be less fees if the pool is larger and able to absorb the risk better. And this causes a situation where the rich gets richer. If we have one pool which for some reason has a bit more miners than the others, then over time, miners will prefer to go from the other pools to this one because it's bigger, so it has better performance. So more miners go to it, and eventually we get into a situation where there's just one pool that is largest and there's no chance for any other pool to compete because it's too small. And no miner would want to mine there. To solve that, we need new methods. And these are based on the concept that a miner doesn't necessarily have to choose a pool, right? In traditional methods, if we have Alice and Bob, then Alice could choose this pool and Bob could choose this pool, but it's not necessary. And the solution is that and every miner can mine in several pools simultaneously. And the way this works depends on whether we're basing on PPLNS or PPS. So if we start with PPLNS, then we have a technique I call simulmine. And if we start with PPS, then we have a technique I call multi-PPS. So simulmine is fairly simple. We have several pools and we have Alice that has some hash power. So instead of just choosing the largest pool, Alice distributes her hash power among the different pools in proportional to how big each is. So if we have a pool that is twice as large than any other, then Alice will mine there with twice as much hash power as the other pools. And this, this actually reduces the variance that Alice has. She will actually have the same variance as if she mined in a single pool with all the hash power of the pools combined. So so this is good for Alice, and it's good for the ecosystem because what Alice is doing is preserving the status quo. She's not giving more weight to the pool that is currently largest. She keeps the ratios the same as they are, and this means the pools can compete on their features and merits or not on whoever happened to be largest first. But if we want to do something which is similar to PPS, then this will not work. We need something slightly different. And and to understand that, we first need to understand the concept of smart mining, which is a different way to do mining in general. So in classical mining, the way it works, we have a miner. It connects to a pool which is also operating a Bitcoin node. The pool gives work to the miner. The miner does work, gives the results to the pool, and the pool, once it sees the result, pays the miner. In smart mining, we separate the roles of the pool and the operator, the pool and the Bitcoin node. So the miner can connect to any node he wants in the network. He can run a node himself or whatever. He gets work from the node. He does work, computes hashes. It gives results to a pool, and the pool pays him. And actually, in the work that the miner has requested, he's specifying that any rewards should go to this specific pool. And even though the pool didn't create the work itself, it can see that the work credits it and pays accordingly. So that's one concept. And the other concept is that actually in each Bitcoin block, the generation transaction that gives rewards to the miner, it actually can have several outputs and can give rewards to several people, several addresses. And this means that a single miner can take work that credits several pools, and it submits the results to each pool and gets pay from each pool. And because, yes, right, so for example, I can try to find blocks which give 5 bitcoins to this pool, 5 bitcoins to this pool, and I get rewards from all of these pools in proportion to how much each is getting in the work that I'm finding. And this actually reduces the risk of these pools because they don't run the risk of a whole block which they could get or not. They only compete on a fraction of it, so it's much lower risk. And since it's much lower risk, they can also charge a much lower proportional fee. So if I connect to all the pools in the world and submit work to each, then I will pay as much fee as if I went to a single large PPS pool with a combined hash power, which would be, of course, much cheaper than just one small pool. And so this can help solve the problem of centralization. With such a method, we don't need to have one huge pool which centralizes the network. We can have many pools. However, it doesn't solve centralization in mining farms. If it's more efficient due to economies of scale to a mine in a single huge centralized farm, so this is a problem that is not solved by multi-PPS. But if we assume that miners mine at home in a decentralized way and just need a pool to mine in, so multi-PPS can decentralize the mining pools. And of course, I didn't go into all the math. If someone is interested, they can read my paper about it, analysis of Bitcoin pool mining reward systems. And if I have some time left, I can accept a few questions.